Hello, my friends. Before the story starts, I would just like to direct this message to new subscribers. In case you don't know, this is not actually a brand new historical feature. This is an old silent one that I have re-edited with narration. I've had a lot of requests for me to do this, and that's exactly what I'm doing now. I'm going through all the older ones without narration, and I'm giving them narration. So the next one will be also a re-edit, and after that will be a brand new historical feature. And so, yeah, without much further ado, let's get into the story. Thanks for watching and listening. George Beau Brummell was a Regency dandy and leader of fashion trends, famous for his cleanliness and elegant dress, his outrageous and witty remarks, and his friendship with George, Prince of Wales, the future George IV. A friendship which enabled his dazzling rise in Regency society, but eventually also his rapid descent from it. Here is his story. George Bryan Brummell, later nicknamed Beau, was born on the 7th of June 1778, the youngest son of Billy Brummell and Mary Richardson. He was born in Downing Street, where his father worked as private secretary to Lord North. In 1783, Billy Brummell retired from political life and bought an estate, Donnington Grove in Berkshire. In 1786, Brummell was sent to Eton with his elder brother, William. They were oppidans, or fee-paying boys, and boarded with Dame Young, in whose house boarded 40 more boys. Brummell mingled with the aristocracy, becoming known for his gentlemanly manners and ready wit, which got him invites to all the best dinner parties. He developed an interest in dress, and his elegant bearing earned him the nickname Buck Brummell. When Brummell's father died in 1794, he left his estate to be shared equally between his three children, rather than everything going to his eldest son. The estate, valued at around £60,000, was to be held in trust until the children came of age. This was a huge fortune, equivalent to more than £5 million in today's money. Brummell went up to Oriel College, Oxford, in May 1794, but after just one term, he asked his father's executors for a commission in the army. He became a cornet in the 10th Light Dragoons. This was the Prince of Wales' very own regiment. Brummell obtained promotion to lieutenant in 1795 and then captain in 1796. And with each promotion came a new and grander uniform. But life in the army had its costs. A fall, or possibly a kick from his horse, broke his nose, damaging his classic profile. It seems incredible that a non-aristocratic lad of 16 should be accepted into the prince's own regiment, and then into his circle of intimate friends. How Brummell first came to the prince's attention is not now known, but it seems likely that it was his wit, abundant charm, and dress sense that attracted the prince, no doubt while Brummell was still at Eton. When the regiment were ordered to Manchester in 1798, Brummell resigned his commission, anxious not to lose his position of influence with the prince. The following year, he came into his inheritance. He was now a man of means, and he meant to make his mark. Brummell moved into 4 Chesterfield Street in 1799 and was determined to become the best-dressed gentleman in London. His receptions became events of great importance as gentlemen, including the Prince of Wales, came to see how he was dressed. It was around 1800, after Brummell's first season in London, that he acquired the nickname Beau. His style was understated elegance, with a limited palette of colours, rather than the gaudy finery of the typical Georgian gentleman. He was famous for the intricate folds of his neckcloth, and the bath coating material of his blue jacket. He patronized various tailors so that not one could say that they had made him famous. Though he flirted prolifically, Brummell's affections were rarely of long standing. Brummell's first love was reputedly Julia Storer, later Julia Johnston, who became a famous courtesan. But his closest lady friend was Frederica, Duchess of York. He loved her carefree house parties at Oatlands and shared her love of animals. He gave her a dog, which was named Fidelite. She sent him gifts when he was in exile, including a comfy chair. One of the few items in Brummell's possession at his death was a miniature painting of Princess Frederica's left eye. This suggests a level of intimacy that can only be now guessed at. Were they lovers? Brummell claimed it was out of respect for his promise to the princess that he refused to publish his memoirs, even when he was in desperate poverty and in need of funds. Brummell was famous for his wit, but also infamous for his rudeness. It was this rudeness which eventually cost him the Prince of Wales' esteem. "Alvanley, who's your fat friend?" he asked, referring to the prince, who, at a dinner ball, had snubbed Brummell. Brummell ran up huge debts, through his extravagance, but also through his heavy gambling losses. He was continually borrowing money, but matters become perilous when a man named Richard Mailer discovered that Brummell was going to renege on his debt to him. He sat in White's Club and told everyone who came of Brummell's shameless conduct. He was, effectively, challenging him to a duel. Mailer had become known as Dick the Dandy Killer. Brummell not only had a problem with the angry dandy killer Mailer, but he owed tailors, tradesmen and shopkeepers for their goods and services. When Brummell was asked how much it would cost to keep a single man in clothes, he was said to have replied, "Why, with tolerable economy, I think it might be done with £800. That would have been a huge sum back in the early 1800s. Bearing in mind the average wage for a craftsman at that time was £1 a week. On top of that, Brummell was hosting expensive dinner parties and balls, and was visiting brothels in the evenings. By this stage, Brummell had decided it would be prudent to depart England. He had angry creditors at his back, the threat of debtor's prison, and the well-aimed musket ball from Dick the Dandy Killer waiting for him. On the 18th of May, 1816, Brummell fled on a coach. He travelled through the night to Dover and then on to Calais, France, which was as far as he could go without a passport. Brummell had escaped his debts, but he could not escape the gnawing fact that he was ill. It is thought that he was in the habit of visiting prostitutes whilst in the army, and at some point late in his time in London, he was infected with syphilis. Before he died in 1830, George IV made Brummell the British consul in Caen. The small salary enabled him to start paying off the debts he had accumulated from his time in Calais. He celebrated his freedom in Paris before taking up his post. But his position as consul did not last when the post was abolished in 1832. Brummell himself suggested that the post be abolished in the hope of a better position. None was forthcoming. His final years were spent in a cheap boarding house in Caen. His only luxuries were two of his favourite biscuits and a cup of coffee, which he obtained on credit from the confectioner. He often couldn't even afford to pay for that, and would be reduced to begging for these small comforts. He was reduced to rags, wretched and semi-paralyzed, looking much older than his actual age. Children would mock and jeer him as he crept along the street to beg for his daily nourishment, supporting himself against the wall as the syphilis racked his mind and body with seizures. As the syphilis slowly flooded his mind with insanity, Beau Brummell would sit by his thin fire at a set table and imagine the entry of long-lost friends and people who had been dead for many years. The imaginary butler would announce their names.
His Royal Highness the Prince Regent.
And cold air would enter from the hallway.
The Duchess of Devonshire. Ah, my dear Duchess,
said the croaky voice, coming with difficulty through almost paralyzed jaws, and his vacant eyes would fill with tears. There he would sit until 10 p.m., talking to ghosts, until the servant announced the carriages and the old man was alone again. At last his state became more distressing, and his intestines became paralyzed, so his bodily functions were no longer under control. This terrible wretchedness made worse by the fact that warmth was his only comfort, and his small monthly pension did not allow him enough fuel. At last it was decided, without his knowledge, that the kind and charitable nuns of the Bon Sauveur should take him in and care for him, where he would have an armchair by a blazing fire. When they came into his room to lead him to the awaiting carriage, nothing could induce him to go. He kept repeating, "Laissez-moi tranquille, leave me alone." Finally, they carried him out, all the time screaming, and then he mumbled through clenched jaws,
"You are taking me to prison. Loose me, scoundrels. I owe nothing."
It was in January 1839 that he was transferred to the asylum, where he died on the 30th of March 1840. His death went virtually unnoticed in England, where he had ruled as King of the Dandies for so long. Once again with those French words. Fools rush in where angels fear to tread. I'll have it perfected eventually. Actually, on my last video, my French viewers, or the native French speakers, even from Quebec, etc., were very kind at my attempts. So I want to thank you for that most sincerely. Sorry, I had to do it again on this one. I don't know why I keep picking a lot of French-themed stories, but I think they crop up quite a few times in my videos. And now to address a few questions. One of them is regarding my accent. People are wondering where I'm coming from, what country I'm living in. Well, I live in Switzerland, but I'm not Swiss. Some people have actually thought I'm actually Swiss. I'm not. I'm Australian of English parents. That's why my accent may be hard for some people to detect. Some people think South African. Well, I'm Australian, just to let you know that. Other people have asked, is it actually me doing the narration, or have I hired a narrator? No, it's actually me. I'm doing it on the cheap, so this is what you get. Now, there have been a lot of comments from people saying that I should get rid of the text slides and just have more photos, and the photos up for a longer duration. So on my next video, the other re-edit, I'm going to put it to a vote. I think YouTube has some sort of vote system. I want you to think about this in the meantime. Please vote. Do you want me to keep the text slides? Which, I don't know, I think might be a good idea for people with hearing problems. And if the vote is close, I'm going to keep the slides, because that means obviously there are a lot of people with hearing problems. But if the vote is overwhelming and unanimous that you really want me to get rid of the text slides and just have the photos, then that's what I'll do. So I'll leave it to you guys. Just think about that over the next week. And on that note, I'll say goodbye. Thank you for watching. Oh, and wow, the last week has been incredible. I mean, I've nearly got 100,000 subscribers, which is awesome, guys. I'm really, really pleased about that. I never expected my last upload to do so well. So that's been a really nice surprise. And what I really like is that I'm getting such a wide age group. I've got older people, I've got young people. They all seem to enjoy what I'm doing. And someone warned me once that people from Reddit were quite unkind, and I haven't found that. I found that the young people who are coming in from, I think it's called Google Youth and Reddit, they've been very polite. So I really, you know, some of the older ones are a lot ruder. So I'm thankful. All of you guys, 99.9% of you have been really so kind. Of course, there's always a few haters. What would YouTube be without that? But they're not going to bother me because I got you guys. You got my back, and that's the main thing. So thank you, and until next time, au revoir. See, that wasn't too bad, was it?